Hello and welcome to part 5 of my Godot VR Weapons tutorial. My name is Bastien Lay, and today we're going to look at reloading our gun after we empty our clip. But first, a big thank you to my Patreon supporters. Yes, I'm on Patreon, so if you want to support what I do, please consider clicking the link in the description below. Today I'm using my Acer MR headset instead of my Rift. I love how I can use this headset just anywhere without having to set anything up, but boy, the controllers are big. Seeing I built this project so far just using the Rift, it's amazing to see it just works with the MR headset. I'm also using new features that were recently added to the visual shader. You'll need a custom build for those. They are not critical, and I will add a shader that works in 3.1 in the example project. We're going to start by adding a press-to-hold mode to our pickable object script. When off, our pickup function works as current. When on, we'll drop our object as soon as we let go of our button. We start by adding a new function to our script that handles our drop code. We simply copy the drop code that is currently in our button pressed function. Now we change our button press code so we only drop our object if needed and call our new function. Next, we do the same for picking up an object. We create a function that handles the pickup and copy our pickup code into it. We're also going to check if we already have an object and drop that one first. And start by checking if the object we're holding is the object we're picking up. In that case, we just return. I'll also add some comments. I forgot to assign the picked up object, so we quickly add that in too. Now we can call this from our button pressed function. Next, we'll write the code for our on button release function. Here we simply duplicate our drop code from our button pressed function, but switch it on our mode being on. We also connect our function to our parent's release signal. Now it's time to figure out which object is closest, and we're going to keep track of that in a variable. We'll add a function that will figure out which object is closest. We'll come back to this in a second. For now, we'll make sure we call it from various places that may impact this object, our process function being the most important one. We want to react on a change, so we'll create a temporary variable for our new closest object. We also set our current closest distance to something far away. Now we loop through our objects list. These are all the objects that were in range of our pickup function. For each object, we calculate the delta between its location and our pickup location. We calculate the distance by taking the length of this delta. If this new distance is closer than our current distance, this object is closer. We assign this object and its distance to our variables, tracking which one is closest. If the closest object we found is different than our current closest object, we need to react to that. If currently we have a closest object, we're going to remove the highlight we'll be adding in a minute. Then we assign our new closest object to our closest object variable. And if this is a new closest object, we need to set the highlight. For now, we pass in both instances. In our pickable object script, we add a function that returns whether our object has been picked up. Back in our pickable function script, we add a check, so we only evaluate objects that haven't already been picked up. Our object could be the closest for both hands. To make sure we track this properly, we'll add a count variable to our script. We add a function to increase this count and decrease this count. Don't worry, I'll fix subtracting 0 in a minute. Next, we add a function called updateHighlight and call it when the count changes. Note that we don't implement anything here. We assume any extended script overrides it instead. We'll quickly fix our decrease. We can now call our increase and decrease functions when our closest object changes. And we change our button pressed function to pick up our closest object. If we have picked up an object, we can optimize our update closest object function by skipping our loop. In order to do our highlight, I'm going to replace our standard material shader with a shader that has a Fresnel effect. I decided to use the visual shader graph here to get a bit of experience with it. I'll do a proper video for that another day. One bit of warning here. Because I'm replacing a material that is linked in multiple scenes that are loaded, I struggled a little with Godot reverting back to the original. I won't show the struggle, but a top tip here is to close all your scenes when you attempt something like this. We start by creating a new shader material by clicking on the New button in the inspector. This creates a new resource instead of a node. Then we select the visual shader in the shader dropdown to create a new visual shader graph. By clicking on the shader, we open up the shader graph. By default, a spatial shader is created, which is what we need. The fragment shader is selected by default, and we see there is already a node there with all our outputs. Any output we do not assign will just have default behavior. We'll start by adding a texture uniform node to our graph. This will allow us to select a texture. We'll call this albedo and make sure we set the mode to color. And we hook up the RGB output to the albedo channel. Now we repeat this for our normal. We need another texture uniform, but this time we set the type to normal map. And we hook up the RGB output to the normal map channel. Next, we add a UV input node, which gives us access to the UVs for our model. We hook this up to the UV input on both our texture uniform nodes. We can click on the little eye icon next to the RGB to get a preview. This can be very helpful at times. Next, we select the texture maps that we're using for our model. I had to click on the eye again to redraw it. A scalar uniform is a node that allows us to input a floating point value. We create this to create our metallic input and hook it up to our metallic channel. Now we repeat that process for our roughness. And we set our values for these, which I copied from the original material. Now we'll save the material and overwrite the material created when we imported our gun. As I said, I'll skip over reloading everything so Godot realizes what I've just done. Next up, we're going to use a Fresnel node, which is a new node being introduced in 3.2. The Fresnel effect relates to reflective surfaces where the reflectiveness of a material seems to increase the more you look at it at an angle. We're going to abuse that angle calculation to create a glow where we are looking at the surface of our gun at an angle. We need to hook up the normal and view input nodes to our Fresnel node to make this node work. Next, we add a multiply node. This allows us to multiply our Fresnel output with another value. We'll multiply our Fresnel with a color uniform. This allows us to set the color of our Fresnel effect. Now we hook the output of our multiply node to the emission channel of our output node. Finally, we set a color for our Fresnel effect. Pretty cool, right? However, we only want this effect when our gun is the closest object, so we need to add a setting for this. To do this, we multiply our Fresnel output by a scalar uniform which we can set. Now we can adjust the value of this new uniform to alter the strength of our Fresnel effect. 0 is off, 1 is normal, and 2 is overpowered. Now we want to control this from code. We're not going to do this in our pickable object script, but I want to copy the name of the function we created. Instead, we're adding the code to our gun script and simply setting our Fresnel strength based on our gun being closest to at least one controller. I did make two mistakes I quickly need to correct. First, we need the material from our mesh, not our mesh instance. Note the inconsistent naming here. Second, our uniform is camel case instead of snake case. I'm just as inconsistent, I guess. It's time we add something else we can pick up. We want to reload our gun, so we're going to create a magazine for it. Unfortunately, our model didn't come with one, so for now we're going to have a simple box to stand in for it. We're creating a new inherited scene from our pickable object scene, and we'll call it magazine. We'll add a mesh instance to our scene and a box mesh to it. I'm saving the scene in our weapons folder and calling it magazine.tscn. Let's select our box and change its size. I'm starting with sizing it 1 cm by 4 cm by 1 cm as a start. We'll temporarily add our magazine scene to our gun scene so we can compare the size. A little wider, perhaps? Wrong axes. Okay, that's looking good. I'm rotating and positioning it to get a better idea. Perhaps a little taller. Yes, that looks pretty good to me. Next, we need to create a matching collision shape. Note that because we're specifying extends, we need to halve our dimensions. Our magazine also needs a material, but we want to reuse our Fresnel shader. I had already saved the Fresnel shader from our gun material off camera. While the shader is shared between the materials, we can set up our own parameters. I'm setting up most of them here, but I missed the ability to set an albedo color. I don't want to use a texture right now. So let's improve our shader graph. I could take a shortcut and simply default our texture to a black texture if no texture is specified. Instead, I'm adding another multiply node and changing it so we're multiplying our texture first. Now we add an albedo color uniform with which we can manipulate our color. If no texture is set, it is white, and multiplying white with another color results in that color. At this point, we do need to go back to our gun scene. We see our gun is black. This is because our default albedo color is black, and multiplying black with our texture results in, black. This is remedied by changing the color to white. Let's quickly remove our magazine scene from our gun scene. I'm adding a few magazines into our main scene. These will nicely stack up on our table. We need to add a little logic to our magazine, so we're going to create a new script. I have no idea why I didn't just change the name in the selection dialog, but oh well. Now we copy our extends line of code from our gun script into our magazine script. We'll also remove the default code. We also copy the code for our highlight from our gun script, but in this case we do use the material we added to our mesh instance. Now we can assign our new script to our magazine scene. We want to be able to pick up items with both hands. To enable this, we'll add our pickup function to our left hand as well. As our teleport doesn't share buttons with our pickup function, this is fine. But if we want to be able to pick our gun up with our left hand, we'll need to do more. I forgot to reposition the function node, which I've done off camera. It's the same as we did with our right hand. In order to reload our gun, we need to know when the player holds a magazine close to our gun. We're going to control this with a new physics layer called ammo. We'll add an area node to our gun scene. This area node will allow us to trigger when a magazine is held in roughly the right place. We'll call this node gun load point. We'll position it where our magazine enters our gun. We add a sphere collision shape. Any magazine that enters our sphere will trigger our reload. On our area node, we set our collision layer to just the ammo layer. This way it will only react to our magazines. Now we hook up our body entered signal of our area node to our gun script. This will be called when a magazine enters our area. The body passed will be our magazine. As our magazine will be spent, we queue free it here. Next, we need to add an export variable that allows us to set the bullets in our magazine. In our signal code, we reset our ammunition count to this new variable. Now I don't want our magazine to just disappear. We want to create a load animation. I'm going back to our magazine scene and we'll save our mesh here. I'm also copying our material into the mesh, but leaving the mesh instance intact. Back in our gun scene, we adjust the gun load point a little more. Then we add a mesh instance for our magazine and load our mesh into it. Some more positioning to get it all into its starting position, and finally we hide our mesh instance. We create a new animation called load. Just like in our last video, we used a key icon to create a keyframe to turn our magazine to visible and get our initial placement right. We move our animation to the last frame and reposition our magazine to be inside of our gun. We again create a keyframe for our position, and we hide our magazine again and create a keyframe for that. That looks good, but it is a little slow. We'll make it twice as fast by dragging our keyframes and changing the length of our animation. Now we go back to our script and we trigger our animation as part of our signal function. The last bit isn't pretty and there is a change coming in 3.2 that will make this nicer. Right now, when our magazine is picked up, we zero out its collision mask. We don't want that. We want the magazine to be in the ammo layer when it has been picked up. So here, I'm adding a new export variable, but hard-coding the layers as flags. We then assign this variable to our collision mask when our object is being picked up. In our magazine scene, we make sure that our magazine is in the environment and object layers when it is not picked up. And then select the ammo layer, which is layer 4, when it does get picked up. We can see our gun glow blue when we move our controller close enough and pick it up. After we empty our clip, we can pick up a new magazine and insert it into our gun. And we crash. In Godot, we can see an error about an invalid index on a previously freed instance. The problem is that we used Q-free to remove our magazine from our scene. We've done this before with our bullets, however. Why is this suddenly a problem? Well, this is because as far as the pickup script on our left controller is aware, we're still holding onto it. So, when I released the button on my controller and let go of the magazine, it didn't like that it wasn't there anymore. So we're going to implement a simple fix for now. Instead of doing our Q-free, we're going to call a method on our pickable object script called dropAndFree. Implementing this in our pickable object script, we are going to make sure we end this method by calling our Q-free. We still need it. Then, we check if we've been picked up and call dropObject on this. We should be picked up by our pickup function, so this should be safe. As we previously prefixed this method with an underscore, we have to remove this. Functions are often prefixed with underscores to denote they are private functions. This is not enforced, but I still follow that pattern. And there we have it. As I'm editing the video, I realize one thing I should have added is a sound while the magazine loads. A lot has been added in this video. We nearly have a complete implementation for our gun. In the next video, we'll add an ammunition counter and look at our muzzle flash. After that, I'm probably first going to look at throwables, and then we'll move on to switching out other weapons. Subscribe if you don't want to miss being notified. If you enjoyed this video, please leave a like. It takes me roughly a month to prepare one of these in-depth tutorials. I'm thinking about doing some smaller things in between. Please consider following me on Twitter for more regular updates on this. Until next time!